You are listening to Concussion 101, a patient's guide to getting ahead again. Episode 13, Who Spiked the Punch? Part 1. Today, your host, Dr. Taher Chugh, Sports MD and Medical Director at the York Region Concussion Clinic, is back again in this episode to discuss common conditions causing dizziness after a concussion. But first, he will explain the physiology behind dizziness and imbalance issues. Enjoy!
Welcome to the 13th episode of this podcast series, Concussion 101. My name is Dr. Maud Boulanger. I'm a medical doctor at the York Region Concussion Clinic, and I'm here today with Dr. Taher Chugh to discuss dizziness and imbalance post-concussion. So, Dr. Chugh, it's reported that dizziness is the third most common symptom post-concussion. Can you talk about what is dizziness?
Most patients know what they're talking about when they say they're dizzy, but doctors often find it hard to understand what they mean. Common adjectives used by patients are things like spinning, floating, rocking, lightheadedness, feeling off or uncoordinated. And, you know, most commonly, they just say they're dizzy.
Generally, can you explain what is causing these symptoms of dizziness?
The body has many different sensory systems. So it has the visual system, the vestibular system, which is part of the inner ear, the somatosensory system, which is the nerves embedded in the skin, and the musculoskeletal system. Each one of these systems handles many functions. These systems communicate with each other in a knee-jerk reflex manner, but also they meet up in the brain and talk. This allows these systems to give us an excellent idea of the world around us and how we fit in physically. This allows us to do all the things we do, from mundane things like loading the dishwasher or typing at the computer, to more complicated things like sports. So when there's a compromise in one or some of these functions, or the way the processing is done in the brain, we can get some symptoms.
So compromised by way of injury or illness, for example.
Right, we get mixed signals and the brain tries to do its best to make sense of it all. And often it reaches the wrong conclusion.
Right, like we're spinning when we actually aren't.
Exactly, the brain takes signals coming from a quote unquote 20/20 eye, for example, or from a normal inner ear, but can't process the signals properly.
An example I've heard you give is that the ingredients in the recipe are all of high quality, but you need to put the right proportion of ingredients to make the dish tasty.
Right. And how efficiently our senses and brain work together also affects our brain's metabolism, which can also have implications on its ability for cognition and mood.
Interesting. So many patients with dizziness have symptoms of anxiety or depression.
Yes, it's reported that 50% of dizzy patients also have clinical mood conditions. And dizziness has to be addressed as part of the treatment plan to improve symptoms. In fact, we've had many patients post-concussion that developed agoraphobia that we treated mostly with vestibular therapy, and their fear of certain places went away.
So for our listeners, agoraphobia refers to patients that get anxiety or panic attacks by going out in open spaces or busy places like a market, because they have a fear of embarrassment or not being able to escape, or the fear of losing control.
In fact, agoraphobia means fear of the marketplace.
Well, actually, Dr. Chugh, the word comes from Greek. Agora means gathering place, so usually a public square where they used to hold assemblies or the marketplace in ancient times, and phobia, which means fear. So you were close, but your Greek is getting a little rusty. So to get back to dizzy post-concussion patients that develop agoraphobia, what you're really seeing is that it's not entirely fear that is to blame.
Vestibular dysfunction has been associated with agoraphobia clinically. And if the symptoms are registered as unpleasant and one develops an aversion to them, one can see how the limbic system may get involved and then send signals that lead to the fight or flight response we discussed in episode 5, I believe.
Mm-hmm. So for our listeners, the limbic system is a group of brain structures that are the seat of our emotional selves. And the amygdala, a part of the limbic system, is known to be the seat of intense emotions like fear. Dr. Chugh, can you explain to the listeners what the vestibular system is?
The vestibular system is a system involved in postural control or balance. Its principal organ, the vestibule, is housed in the labyrinth, a pea-sized structure in the inner ear. The other organ housed in the labyrinth is the cochlea, which is used for hearing. The vestibular system is structured in a way that it senses changes in head position in all directions. It also has some automatic reflexes between itself, the eyes, the neck, and the entire body. So as the head's position changes, these systems, you know, the eyes, the neck, the body, can automatically adjust without conscious processing so that we can quickly and efficiently navigate through this world.
And so these signals from the vestibule then go to the brain.
Right. This is where the signals are processed in conjunction with other signals coming from other systems. And then the signals will go on to the eyes, the neck, limbs, autonomic nervous system, and so on. For example, a sudden tilt of the floor, say in a testing lab, will cause an automatic rotation of your eyeballs so the image you see remains stable. Also, certain muscles will also fire automatically to make sure you don't fall.
So this whole system, inner ear to the brain, to the outputs like the eyes, neck, and musculoskeletal system, is known as the vestibular system.
Right.
So how common are vestibular issues post-concussion?
Well, the most common vestibular issues we see post-concussion are BPPV, vestibular migraines, and regression in the way we weigh and process our sensory inputs to reach conclusions about how we're situated in our environment physically.
There are many terms for this third condition you mentioned, but generally we refer to it as a mismatch between the visual, vestibular, and somatosensory system, or for short, VVM, or visual vestibular mismatch.
Right.
Can you describe BPPV to us?
Most of us have heard of this before. It is also a common vestibular condition in the non-concussion population. BPPV stands for benign, paroxysmal, positional, vertigo. The name describes it well. It's benign, which implies it's not a stroke or something serious like that. It's paroxysmal, meaning it comes and goes. It depends on the patient's head position. And it's described as vertigo or a sense of spinning. It happens in about a third of our patients, of our post-concussion patients.
Many people would have heard this referred to as crystals in the ear. Many people wonder how crystals can end up in the ear.
Right. Let me describe the anatomy first, and then understanding the condition becomes easy. So, in the vestibular system we talked about earlier, there's a vestibule on each side of the head because there's two inner ears. There are three rings in each vestibule. These rings are called semicircular canals. These rings are filled with fluid. They are oriented perpendicular to each other, similar to the X, Y, and Z axis in geometry.
So kind of like how the walls in the corner of a room come together.
Right, exactly. At the base of each of these rings, inside the rings, there is a switch-like structure called the ampulla. As we turn our head, the fluid inside those rings moves a certain way under the laws of physics, and the switch will in turn get pushed. And then when that switch gets pushed, it sends nerve impulses to the brain. This way, the brain can interpret head motion. So in any of the geometrical planes, the X, Y, and the Z axis, or for our American colleagues, the Z axis, turning the head in one direction causes the switches to go one way, and turning it another way causes them to go another way.
So this is normal physiology.
Right. So in BPPV, crystals get in there and throw off the way the fluid moves when we move our head. And this is when the switch doesn't get moved as expected. What then happens is that we get the impression that we're moving in a direction. That is, our vestibular system tells the brain we're moving, but our eyes and our somatosensory system tells that we aren't. This leads to dizziness, and more accurately, vertigo.
So can you explain where these crystals come from?
In the vestibular system, there are these two structures, the saccule and the utricle. They together are known as the otolith organs. They are kidney-shaped structures, very small enough to fit in those pea-sized inner ear organs I discussed earlier. and they are studded with tiny, tiny limestone crystals on the top surface. The otolith organs are designed to detect translational forces, so like the force you feel when you're on an elevator or a walk-a-later. These crystals naturally fall off from time to time and just dissolve or get reabsorbed by the body. But if these crystals happen to make their way into one of those nearby semicircular canals, then they will throw off the fluid dynamics, as I explained. Sometimes the crystals are free-floating in the semicircular canals, and sometimes they're caked onto that switch, that ampulla I mentioned earlier. And this distinction is important as it changes the treatment slightly.
So concussion makes these crystals fall off the otolith organs more easily?
It is more likely you will have BPPV if you have a concussion. And concussion patients have a higher chance of having more than one of these semicircular canals affected, making the dizziness more intense as motion in more planes will be affected. In the general population, this condition becomes more common in people 60 and above.
Can you explain how one knows they have BPPV?
The history is very important. It has a typical history of sudden, intermittent spells of vertigo triggered by head motion in certain planes of motion. Most patients won't be able to tell you in which plane they feel their vertigo come on, but they'll say certain activities tend to bring it on. The vertigo most commonly lasts seconds, but sometimes it can last over a minute. The vertigo usually settles down once the patient stops moving, and if the patient moves repeatedly over and over, the experience kind of fatigues and peters out. But if there's a long break from the same motion, the vertigo comes back again upon doing that movement again. This could be due to the crystal kind of settling in one area as the patient repeatedly does the same thing. For example, if the patient was jogging, it's conceivable that the crystals kind of settle in the place where they feel the most stable. So they kind of end up moving less with motion until the patient does something completely different and stirs them up again.
I know patients really find the infrared goggles used cool.
Yeah, the infrared goggles, the Frenzel goggles, right. Mm-hmm. So these are goggles. They're known as video Frenzel lenses, and they're used to detect this condition. By knowing the orientation of each of these six semicircular canals, we can position the head in a plane parallel to each one of those canals and then turn the head to get the crystal on the move and then see the effect it has on eye movement. Normally, if there are no crystals, the eyes move kind of like a doll's eye would move upon turning the doll's head. This is a natural reflex. However, when there is a crystal, the eyes move differently because they receive a message that the head is turning. And when the eyes can't move any more past the socket, they jerk back and start again. This jerk-like motion is known as nystagmus. By identifying the pattern of nystagmus, how long it lasts, and in which position it's elicited, we can tell what kind of stone you have, which canal it's in, and the right treatment to help fish that crystal out of the inner ear.
And the most effective treatment for BPPV is not usually medication.
Right. Medication just helps make the feelings of dizziness less intense. But actually, fishing the crystal out with a specific physical maneuver that usually sees the patient moving in a way that slowly drains each part of the affected semicircular canal sequentially until the whole ring has been sort of like wrung out or drained.
And what is success rate of doing the maneuver generally?
There are several different maneuvers depending on the details surrounding the crystal type and position. The success rates range from 60 to 90%. In our practice, we have generally not had to do the maneuver more than three times, on three different visits for a given crystal. Sometimes, like maybe 5% of the time, the crystals get repositioned to another canal, and then it has to be removed from that new canal with a different maneuver. Only three times have we had patients that had their symptoms outlast their three attempts at crystal repositioning. All three patients had other diagnoses contributing to their dizziness, in addition to the BPPV. Both were sent to a local dizziness and balance center ran by a neurotologist. In the first lady, one test called an ECOG was the only abnormality seen. This result is not a very convincing test alone, which highlights the importance of taking a good history from the patient. But, you know, after it was all kind of assessed, she was felt to have endolymphatic high drops, or ELH, in addition to recurrent BPPV. The ELH could be the beginning of Meniere's disease, and so could have just been a coincidental finding that she developed post-concussion, or maybe it was already kind of brewing before concussion, or it could be secondary to post-concussion. Generally, if it happens due to concussion, it tends to resolve on its own after 2 years. No one can tell what will happen until it happens.
And for the other two patients?
We're actually just waiting to hear back from the Dizziness and Balance Center, although for both, I feel they have vestibular migraines and BPPV. Actually, BPPV is much more common in people with migraines than they'd be in people without migraines in the general public who don't have concussions.
Yes, I was surprised to read that 22% of migraineurs get BPPV. And when you combine this with the fact that post-concussion patients get more complicated BPPV, more canal involvements, and so on, it can be more resistant to treatment.
Yeah, it's an interesting stat, and the exact mechanism of why that is still unknown.
There are a few rarer vestibular consequences that can happen post-concussion, like the ELH in that first lady, but I didn't plan to get into those today in case our listeners were wondering. I wanted to keep it about the more common things we see. I just wanted to go back to the video friends lenses for a minute. The lenses, software, and computer can run close to 10K. I imagine that this is not within the means of many healthcare practitioners, especially in Canada in a public healthcare system. How important are they?
The literature reports that the incidence of BPPV in the post-concussion population runs around 30%. Before we used video frenzels, we were seeing BPPV in only about 5% of our patients using the old-fashioned frenzel lenses that doesn't use infrared technology. The old-fashioned lenses are high-power lenses, 20 diopters, with a little light inside the goggles. So the lens causes the patient to see very blurry, and the practitioner can see the eyes magnified, kind of like minions. And the problem with this is that the light coming through the lens can cause the patient to fixate or lock in their focus on the light, overriding the jerk nystagmus that we want to see. When we got the video frenzels, we found that the incidence of BPPV in our population went from 5% to 30%. Since 30% is what is in the literature, we feel it's not a coincidence, but that we were missing many cases of BPPV before we made the switch.
I know treating this condition is very satisfying for patients and healthcare practitioners. Many patients come in smiling and enthusiastically comment how much a difference that simple 3-minute maneuver made in their symptoms.
Yeah, it's not common in neurological rehabilitation to have a passive therapy that brings so much relief. So we take it when we can. Mm-hmm. Patients will notice that many of their symptoms will get better, not just the dizziness. Obviously, balance and visual processes improve. Energy levels get better, and they feel more happy and optimistic. Headaches get better. Without treating the BPPV, it's hard to treat other things these patients are feeling. It's kind of like the mouse to your computer is not calibrated properly, although it's a simple problem. It's hard to work with a computer until you kind of calibrate that mouse.
Right. Now, most patients feel better immediately, or some really notice a difference the next day?
Well, some patients have been unintentionally avoiding the head positions that make their symptoms worse. So by the time they test out those head positions, usually the following morning when they're getting out of bed, they notice they don't get the dizziness. But also for many of our patients, they've been struggling with BPPV for some time. We mentioned that in post-concussion patients, they tend to get it more recurrently and in multiple canals. So they unintentionally try to adapt to their experience internally in the way they move, the way they perceive the world, but also in activities in which they involve themselves. For many vestibular conditions, adaptation is a good strategy that can be relied upon. But because of the nature of BPPV, the way the crystal moves with any given movement won't be exactly the same. And so the brain can't make a stereotypical reaction that will suit all possibilities, or a stereotypical guesstimate of what will happen. So many of our patients who have had this for a while have a second type of dizziness that goes by many different names. It's known as chronic subjective dizziness. You mentioned it earlier, visual vestibular mismatch. And sometimes it's severe enough to be called persistent postural perceptual dizziness, or simply 3PD, as there's a lot of P's. It's not uncommon for this component of the dizziness to fizzle out over a day to a couple of weeks after you kind of reposition that crystal or fish it out of that canal. But sometimes you need additional rehabilitation because the adaptation to the crystal ends up kind of complicating matters, and that needs to be undone.
Now, chronic subjective dizziness is a common cause of dizziness in the concussion population, even when they didn't also get BPPV.
Chronic subjective dizziness, or CSD, is a grab bag term that describes a type of dizziness that is felt all day for most days for a period of time longer than 3 months, and it waxes and wanes with motion, with visual environment and visual tasks. There is some overlap here with post-concussion visual syndrome, which is discussed in two articles on our website titled Post-Concussion Vision Syndrome, I believe, and Visual Vestibular Mismatch. But chronic subjective dizziness implies that in the same way pain is processed in our brain during, for example, a migraine, the same sort of processing can happen for dizziness rather, as opposed to pain.
We went into some detail regarding what was happening at the brain level during headaches in episodes 9 and 10, and I feel being able to explain the science in similar fashion normalizes the dizziness experience and validates the different aspects of treatment of dizziness like it does for headaches.
Absolutely. Patients like to hear that, you know, what they're feeling is not just in their head, it's a real neurophysiological thing. Although it has kind of this grab bag term, CSD. CSD is now conceptualized as either persistent failure to readapt after the initial impairment to posture, balance, or eye control resolves. So for example, in this case, a failure to readapt after the crystal has been repositioned. So they had a crystal, it's been repositioned, it's gone, that vertigo is gone, but they're still dizzy because of this failure to readapt. Or CSD can be seen as a persistent use of high-risk balance strategies that are out of proportion to what is necessary to compensate for a chronic balance issue. So like, for instance, you kind of bump into something or you kind of misstep and you kind of overreact like the way you would probably on a shaky boat on water, you know, even though you're just on solid land. Those type of things.
Okay. Many healthcare practitioners find these patients challenging to treat because they tend to appear very anxious.
Yeah, and this is a bit of a chicken and the egg sort of thing. Like we discussed earlier, these symptoms can cause anxiety, but anxiety can also worsen balance symptoms. For example, studies have shown that anxiety is correlated with less efficient balance and movement strategies in the face of many of the activities we find ourselves in every day.
So are those with anxiety post-concussion more likely to develop dizziness?
Studies have shown that those that responded to their situation more assertively, rather than fearing and avoiding exacerbations of their symptoms, were less likely to develop chronic dizziness. So in particular, high levels of anxiety at the onset of vertigo, excessive vigilance about the vestibular symptoms, so being very afraid of experiencing that dizziness, and then having catastrophic thinking about the possible adverse outcomes of the dizziness. So, you know, always thinking the worst that's going to happen. I'm going to do this and I'm going to get really dizzy and then I'm going to feel terrible. These type of things are the best predictors for persistent dizziness and unsteadiness.
So in a sense, CSD, of which anxiety is often a part, is a failure of readaptation of effective postural control strategies that mark recovery.
Yes. It's for these reasons that CSD is treated in a multidisciplinary, multimodal environment to address all facets of the dizzy experience. It's not a unidimensional experience.
I'm going to zero in on sensory organization dysfunction, or what we often call visual vestibular dysfunction. Can you describe what that is?
I think it's best to think of this in the context of normal human development. As a child develops, the visual system, the vestibular system, and the somatosensory system develop many skills. Each system develops at its own rate. The somatosensory system developing first. So by about the age of 3.5, kids will have a very good somatosensory system.
Yes, any parent who takes their kids to the park or to gymnastics can see that. However, their postural control is not quite as good as it will be.
Yes, that's because the aspects of the vestibular system that feed information from the inner ear to the musculoskeletal system in setting up automatic postural reflexes and movement strategies will continue to develop into the late teens. The visual system is similar in that even athletes now are doing something called sports vision training to gain that competitive edge. These signals come together in the brain and are processed to decide on the best movement strategy. When one of these signals are off, or when the way they are processed moves away from what's ideal because of a concussion, for example, you get symptoms. Anyone who has been seasick or carsick before will appreciate that it doesn't really help to read a book while bouncing up and down. Your visual system is just focused on the book, and so your visual system may underestimate the amount by which you're moving. And the vestibular system is telling you that it is moving, and therein lies the rub.
We have more details about the science behind this for our listeners who are interested in a well-lit-up article on our website. It's called Visual Vestibular Mismatch. But basically, for those that have this condition, there is a metabolic change in the brain that causes a change in the way these signals are automatically processed, changing our perception of the world or how we fit in.
Right. That summarizes it pretty well, actually. This automatic process usually happens in the background during everything we do, so most of us aren't even aware of its importance. But these processes create a body schema, or an internal map of the limits of our body and how it relates to our environment. Like this, it serves as the benchmark from which operates many processes like the visual system, our neuromuscular control, stress regulation, and mental efficiency. In fact, in many of our patients who have visual issues like those described in the previous episode, the one on vision with Dr. Ubi, the benefit from vision therapy will be reduced until the spatial awareness and body schema is restored.
An example that you give that really paints the picture well is that if a camera is giving you a blurry image, you will want to make sure that your hand is steady before you start fiddling with focusing the lens.
Right. It's common sense. I think in the last episode on vision, Dr. Ubi even mentioned how some patients' visual issues resolve significantly by doing somatosensory and vestibular training.
Kind of like giving people exercises that they will have encountered when they were toddlers.
Sometimes we go back earlier, before toddler years even, depending on the patient. For example, we may start with exercises that they may have done for the first time when they were just a few months of age. It's not a coincidence that some fundamental binocular vision processes only come online once neck neuromuscular control is gained around 4 months. So training people to move their core muscles and their neck in a similar fashion to facilitate higher order visual processes is important.
It's amazing that simple things like how to properly move the neck are lost with our modern lifestyle, poor ergonomics, irregular exercise, stress, and so on. And that many of us get away with it until an injury like a concussion exploits this kink in the chain.
This is why a multimodal, multidisciplinary approach is most efficient in this context. Really, we would like to retrain the postural control system under the circumstances in which it first developed.
You mean when they were very young?
Yes, exactly. We've all heard some expert teachers say, "I want you to come to me as a blank slate," because some of the stuff you learned before will work against you. And what they're referring to is those bad habits or those shortcuts that you picked up along the way. It's interesting because a neuroscientific paper just came out showing that learning certain habits as represented by certain groups of the brain networks firing together in a specific pattern may make it harder for certain other things to be learned, represented by a different firing pattern in those brain networks. So this is not to say you shouldn't learn. It just means that specializing in one thing may lessen your ability to specialize in another thing, everything else being equal.
That's interesting, because in our North American culture, we seem to have the impression we can do it all and that our returns will be proportional to our effort. So really, sometimes less is more.
Isn't it interesting that in Finland, they are finding their children are doing better in school with less classroom time?
Yes, indeed. So as it relates to sensory organization dysfunction, basically you want adults not to use their relatively overdeveloped visual system when doing postural control exercises, as they didn't have visual system that developed when they were kids.
That's a common theme, and yes, that is true for a large proportion of our patients. It involves a bit of mindfulness training and systematic drills to set up the conditions under which people can learn to retrain the way they organize and process these senses. But the results are phenomenal. This principle of thinking smart and strategically, rather than working harder with the skills you are already savvy in using, is used by athletes who are training for the Olympics, for example, or by investors looking for the maximal returns on investment. It often happens that these athletes have a relatively successful strategy when doing their sport, but many strategies have a ceiling effect, meaning they can do it that way and they're really good at doing it that way, but they won't be able to make it or take it much farther with using that same strategy. So performance coaches will often get them to use different strategies that offer them more potential. So like any investment, at first, they're not as good at this strategy. And so the performance goes down a bit, but after about 4 weeks, they have after they've successfully integrated the new approach, the bar starts getting set higher and higher.
It's like an investment. It costs some to make an investment, but once it starts bearing fruit, you're happy you did it.
Exactly. There are two patients we had in the last 6 months that really stand out in my memory that are good examples of the success that can be had by simply taking this philosophy to heart. Just basically introducing them to the philosophy of sensory reorganization allowed them almost entirely to reduce their dizziness within 2 weeks. For most patients, they can have an excellent outcome in 4 weeks of consistent daily exercises.
So to summarize again, sensory reorganization is about giving progressively more challenging motions that patients naturally try to do as infants and then children and then teenagers. But this time you're getting them to do it with mindfulness so they maximize our gains.
Yes, that's perfectly put. To adopt a spirit of mindfulness involves a sense of letting go and not having any expectations or goals. Just like a two-year-old toddles about without expectations or goals, just curiosity about what's possible.
Thank you, Dr. Chugh, for that discussion. I'd like to continue this next time by discussing vestibular therapy and other common things we see in dizzy patients after a concussion or patients with balance issues.
No problem. My pleasure.
Thank you for listening to the Concussion 101 podcast. If you enjoyed it, please subscribe to our podcast on iTunes and leave us a review. For more information about concussion-related topics, visit us at www.yorkconcussion.ca. Stay tuned for our next episode.